Bonsoir, good evening, and welcome everyone. The concert tonight is dedicated to my dear nephew, Jordan Fieldman, who died on June 1st, 2004. In his memory, we are playing the Schumann Piano Quintet, which has an exquisitely beautiful slow movement. Enjoy the concert. Bon concert.
Good evening, and welcome to this Allegro Chamber Music concert. Tonight, performed in Paulet Hall, on the campus of McGill University in Montreal. We open tonight's concert with the music of Gustav Mahler. At the beginning, at the turn of the 20th century, in 1901 and 1902, Mahler finished a song cycle on the poetry of the German poet Friedrich Rückert, Mahler's Rückertlieder. One of those songs has become arguably the most beloved song written by Mahler. It's entitled, Ich bin der Welt abhanden gekommen, which means, I'm alone and abandoned in this world. In fact, this piece is so loved, the manuscript for this piece recently sold at Sotheby's Auction House in London for almost £1 million. The poem evokes the peace achieved through the necessary withdrawal of the artist, or the composer, or the poet, from the turmoil and the noise and the quotidian grind of everyday life to a place where that person can concentrate on what is essential and meaningful in their life, which is their art. Mahler identified very strongly with this piece. In fact, he said, this piece depicts me. It's not hard to imagine that what he most associated with was the last stanza of the poem. Ich lieb allein, I live alone. In meinem Himmel, in my heaven, in meinem Lieben, in my love, in meinem Lied, in my song. This is Ich bin der Welt abhanden gekommen in my arrangements for clarinet and string quartet.
Thank you.
The significance of Clara Schumann in the life of Johannes Brahms cannot be understated, nor probably will it ever be fully understood. Throughout his life, Brahms sent Clara his sketches and his unfinished works for her comments and her approval. Brahms showed up at the Schumann household at the age of 20, and he rented a room in their house, ostensibly to study with Robert Schumann. Everything was wonderful in the beginning. Brahms worshipped the Schumanns. The Schumanns loved Brahms like a son. But in a letter that exists to this day, which Brahms wrote to his friend Joseph Joachim, the violinist, he admitted to Joachim that he was in fact falling in love with Clara. This was awkward on several levels, as she was his teacher's wife, she was 13 years his senior, she had 7 children, and she was often not there. She was one of the piano virtuosis of the 19th century, and she was constantly concertizing and always on tour. Some evenings, when Robert Schumann was not at home, Brahms would ask Clara if he could play for her certain works in progress. Of course, he played for her some of his most touching and fetching slow movements. And Clara saw right through this ruse. She saw it for what it was, which was a covert love letter from Brahms to Clara. And one evening, she even admonished Brahms for such a churlish endeavor. After Robert Schumann died, Brahms and Clara remained fast friends. They wrote to one another almost every day, sometimes several times a day. But later in life, Brahms asked Clara to destroy all his letters to her, and he destroyed all her letters to him. But luckily for us and for posterity, the eldest Schumann daughter, Eugenie, had the presence of mind to save some of those letters that she found. So we know the intensity of the relationship between Brahms and Clara. But despite that intensity, they seem to remain aside one another, but at a distance. They were alongside one another in life, but always at an arm's length. Later, when Clara died, on the day of her funeral, Brahms wrote a friend, quote, "Today I bury the only person I truly love," unquote. One of the last collections of music that Brahms wrote that was published in his life, just before Clara died, are the 3 collections of piano solo intermezzi, Opus 117, 118, and 119. Opus 118, set of 6 intermezzi, were actually dedicated to Clara, and it's as though now, late in life, Brahms could finally write an overt love letter to Clara. One of the most beautiful aspects of these pieces is that it's as though there are 2 characters, 2 vocal subjects that sing to one another. One can easily imagine it's Brahms singing to Clara, Clara singing back. In the arrangement you'll hear tonight, which is my arrangement for clarinet and string trio, those 2 singing characters are represented in the clarinet and the violin. So we hope you enjoy my arrangements of 3 intermezzi, originally for solo piano, tonight for clarinet and string trio.
Thank you. We will continue now with a performance of the Schumann Piano Quintet. Piano quintets are such an integral part of the chamber music repertoire of today that it would be natural to think that this was always the case, but in fact this was not so. And the piano quintet of Robert Schumann is considered the first masterpiece in this genre. Prior to composing this piano quintet, Schumann focused on solo piano repertoire, songs for voice and piano, and symphonic repertoire. And one can hear the synthesis of all these styles in this quintet. In this quintet, we hear brilliant solo piano writing, intimate and intricate interaction between the string instruments, all creating a bold and romantic, almost orchestral sound. This quintet is dedicated to Robert Schumann's wife, the pianist and composer Clara Schumann, who went on to perform this quintet many times, and to whom the work is dedicated. Clara Schumann was not, however, to perform the premiere of this quintet, as she was suddenly taken ill at the last minute, and she was replaced literally minutes before the first performance, almost unbelievably, by the composer Felix Mendelssohn, who happened to be attending in the audience and accepted to read the piano part at sight. This quintet is in the standard four movements of classical style. The first movement is broad, bold, symphonic in scope, energetic and passionate. The second movement begins with a funeral march, but at times this funeral motif becomes agitated, then serene. It goes through the gamut of emotions. The third movement is a scherzo. It has been said that every scherzo contains a joke, and our pianist Dorothy mentioned in rehearsals that, in her opinion, the joke in this movement is the piano taking off like a galloping horse, and the string players are trying to get back on the horse. In the fourth movement, we see the fruits of Robert Schumann's study of Bach and Baroque counterpoint, ending with a dramatic fugue with the opening motif of the first movement as the fugal subject. We hope you enjoy this performance of Robert Schumann's Piano Quintet in E flat major. Thank you.
Thank you.